Hey, welcome back to the Pokemon Radar podcast. We're at episode 10, double digits. The first time here. It's honestly, I didn't think I'd make it this far, but here we are. Today we have a very special guest. I'd like to think of him as our father of Discord and one of the greatest PSA 9 collectors out in the world. That at least
special guest
that I know of. We have Pokemon Flying Master, who I will refer to as PFM. Hey, how you doing, PFM?
Good. How's it going?
It's going great, man. Welcome.
First, I just want to ask, are you ready for the greatest Pokemon Radar podcast that you've had so far?
Absolutely. I am very excited to hear what you have to say. You've been a little quiet on Discord lately, so I'm happy you're able to join and talk a little bit here. So
glad to be here. Episode 10. I love it.
Big numbers here. Big numbers. We're doing it big. You know, you're also the very first, or I guess second international guest I've had. You're from the Great North, Canada.
I apologize in advance for my Canadianism. I apologize for apologizing, but here
well,
we are.
Instead of using the dollar amounts, we'll be using loonie and toonies. So.
Oh yeah, you know your stuff.
But. Yeah, so let's jump right into it. How I like to start all my podcasts. You know, I want to get to know PFM a little bit. How Pokemon affected your life early on in the world of our great childhood back in the 90s. So, what was it like in 1999 in Canada? Are you in like Midwest, East? Where are you located?
I'm on the East Coast. I'm in Ontario. There's like three places where people live in Canada, and I'm in like near Toronto. I'm in Toronto actually, but I grew up around that area.
Okay, good. So big city, you had access to Pokemon back then? Did you with the cards?
The one thing about collecting the cards back in the day was that like my mom, like as a kid, you don't have money to spend of your own. Right. At least at that age, I was probably like, I don't know, seven around the time, 1999.
Mm-hmm.
Seven. And you don't have like money to spend of your own. So you're really, it's all in your parents' interest in the hobby. That's how far your interest can extend, right?
Yep.
And my mom always said, oh, it'll just be a fad. Like, oh, he'll grow out of it in like 6 months or something. And even to this day, she doesn't believe that, like, I'm still collecting Pokemon cards. So I can remember vividly the first card I was given was by some kid, like a grade older than me. He was in grade six. I was in grade five, I think. Maybe a little bit younger. It doesn't matter. But it was like a fake base set Staryu. And I still have that card till today. I think if you scroll all the way down to the bottom of my Instagram, which you don't have to do,
it's
there.
That's awesome. A fake Staryu. There were fakes that early on. That's incredible. There it is. First edition one,
there
too.
There it is. First edition fake. Look at that.
Right off center. It's shadowless. It's got some good color.
That was my first card. And once I like, it was popular. People were talking about it. I just didn't have it because my parents never bought me. And when I had it in my hands, I'm like, holy, I love this stuff.
Did you watch the show beforehand, like before the cards?
Oh, yeah.
Did you knew what Pokemon was when you saw this card?
Yeah. I don't know if I was playing the game at the time. My first game was Yellow, so like I was kind of late to the scene again because like my parents just were never like on the cutting edge of Pokemon.
Well, were you are you an only child?
No, I'm the oldest of three.
Okay, so that's why. So yeah. I mean, we're about the same age. I mean, yeah, I was born in '93, so
92.
I wouldn't have caught on to this stuff unless I had two older brothers. Oh, great. I got alarms going off in the background. Fantastic. Perfect timing. All right. That's going to be annoying. But, God damn it.
Should you evacuate?
Yeah, I think they're just doing some testing. We'll just go through it. Hopefully it's not too annoying. Oh, there we go. It stopped.
Okay, we're good.
But yeah, I had older brothers who were a little bit more conscious of what was going on and into this stuff. So thankfully I was able to get into it a little bit earlier. But yeah, same thing. Like, I mean, yeah, I had maybe $5 a week for chores, and I could buy a pack or buy some loose cards, so it wasn't like I was getting a ton of that stuff. So you started with base set, obviously, whether it was fake or not.
Yeah, funny story. The first pack I got, it was from the Tooth Fairy.
Okay, wow.
Spoiler, like, Tooth Fairy's not real. But it was a fake base set pack.
What?
And at the time, I knew it was fake, too, so I'm like, Oh, thanks. Tooth Fairy, like, great. Find counterfeit
What did
stuff.
it look like? Was it like Pikachu on the art, or was
It
it?
was weird. It had like a flap where you fold up, and then there was the cards inside, and it was made out of cardboard, not like I don't know, whatever packs are made out of, foil.
Oh.
But it was clearly fake, and I knew as a kid too. So yeah, I had a lot of fake stuff as a kid. And then when I finally start getting like real cards for like my birthday when I was like a little bit older, way more into it at that time, it was always like theme decks. So I had like the Lapras theme deck,
Okay.
right?
Yeah.
So all the holos I had were like the garbage theme deck, unlimited holos.
Okay. Yeah.
So
Yeah.
I started from humble beginnings, let's put it that way.
Well, look at you now. You're
And
on
still
another
humble,
level. Still
PSA 9.
Well, okay. So, were you aware of any first edition or Shadowless stuff back then? Oh, here we go again. Oh. It's up. Okay. Are you
Okay.
were you aware of first edition Shadowless or any of that stuff back in the day?
I definitely knew about first edition, and I know I was like, a lot of people don't talk about like knowing Shadowless until a lot later, but I knew at like, let's say around when I was 10, like the difference. And I would have in my binder, I used to put cards in binders like everyone. I would have like a, I would put the first edition in if I had it. If not, I would put the Shadowless one in. If not, I would put the unlimited one in.
Just because I mean
Yeah.
you kind of notice the color difference, I guess,
Yeah.
and all that. All right, so you were a yellow version guy. That's the first yellow version I had of people that is what they started with.
Yeah.
So that was the first stuff, obviously. What how far did you get into Pokemon back in the day? Did you obviously go through Fossil, Jungle, Team Rocket? How far did you get for, I guess, you stopped, or did you stop at all?
I would probably say I stopped right around, again, like I didn't really have many packs. Like I remember being really into it during Neo, but like I would just never get packs because I wasn't buying any. My parents weren't buying any for me. But like, you know, I would get Neo cards from kids at school or whatever. Like my cousins had some Neo cards and I always want them. Like, look at that Houndour, so cool. And then maybe around E series is when I kind of stopped collecting, just like a lot of people. But like not for long, because I started up again more seriously when I actually started having money and I could buy packs, and I was gifted packs like right around like Ruby Sapphire. So
So
like
like
a
2000,
year later.
2003, 2004. Well, that was 2003 was like middle school. You must have just been a freshman in high school then.
No, I
Or
was younger than
maybe
that. Probably
maybe
like late, like grade 7 or 8 or something like
Okay.
that.
So what were you doing part time or did full time?
Just it was like you were talking about like chores, like just like stuff at home, like $5 a week or whatever.
Gotcha. And you were just
And then
focused
I
on
kind of
buying
like,
Pokemon with that.
not much, but you know, a pack every once in a while,
Did
rather than a theme deck on your birthday.
you have like a local shop that you would go to, or was it just kind of random 7-Eleven or Tim Hortons, I guess?
I grew up in the boonies, like so. I don't know if that's like, is that a Canadian thing? It's like the country. So I couldn't just walk and go somewhere and buy stuff. So it was like every time we were like at Walmart or some place that had it, I would buy it. But like later around the EX era, like probably around the EX Deoxys or something around then, I actually started playing and I would go to a league at like downtown in my city. Here we go again.
Just once that time. Okay. All right. You
Okay, we're good.
we're good.
Yeah, so I'd actually go to the league and I remember like buying like the packs now that everyone wants, like all the, you know, Unseen Forces, Deoxys, Team Rocket Returns. I would buy like, and that's when I actually had like a decent flow of money. I'd go every week to the league, buy like 2 packs, open them up. You know,
Gold
I think
Star hunting.
if you go down to the bottom of my Instagram, you can see the 4 gold stars that I where is it? Up a little bit right there. That yeah. So those are 4 that I actually pulled
Oh wow.
like during that era.
Did you get them graded?
Yes. So right now the Mewtwo's a 10, the Rayquaza's a 4, the Raikou's an 8, and the Regirock's a 9.
Wow, so you played with the Rayquaza then.
It was I really liked it, and I wouldn't really play with it, but you know, I would take it out and always
Just
look at
handle
it.
it. Yeah, I gotcha. Well, that's
My
cool.
bait.
Were you any good at the game? Were you winning these tournaments?
No. You don't win tournaments when you buy 2 packs a week. Like I wasn't buying singles either, so I was just playing with whatever holo card I got. Like it was mostly for fun.
This is terrible timing. All right. That's yeah, that's right. That was interesting because yeah, I never played the game. Never have. I mean, I guess I did, but we like rarely even like used energies. We would just go out there and put out the Charizard and just try to stomp each other. But yeah, I never went to leagues or anything like that. That's kind of cool. Have you ever thought about getting back into it and playing or?
Nah, like I don't know, like last year I was playing the online game and it's fun, but I just find that like it gets to a certain point where at a certain level of competitiveness, like everyone's kind of using the same decks.
Yeah.
And you just kind of see the same things, and I like the creativity of it a little bit more, so.
Right, right. And you can just go online and find the decks and do all that, and yeah, I got you. That makes sense.
I don't have the desire to like research what decks are winning or who's playing what or whatever.
Okay. So you jumped right back into the EX series, and you were buying packs kind of through every new set up until now?
No. Let's see. It was around. Oh, I went through the Holon, the Delta Species.
Mm-hmm.
I think on somewhere on my Instagram there, I have like a box of Holon Phantoms that I opened up. It was like one of the few booster boxes I opened up as a kid.
Okay.
And at this point, I'm like high school, so I don't know if you want to call that a kid, but.
Yeah.
Around like right after the Delta kind of era finished off, I kind of stopped for a bit.
Okay. Okay. Went to university and.
Yes.
Started
university, and then actually in university, I found a couple friends, and we just started like buying packs for fun. This is during Black and White.
Mm-hmm.
So I have a few. Actually, we bought a lot because we had more money again. So we bought some like booster boxes together and cracked them open, black and white stuff.
That's cool. I had friends do that with Yu-Gi-Oh when they were in college, just with the roommates. They'd get together and just play randomly.
Yeah.
Buy boxes and packs of whatever and do that, which is the most fun. I think, you know, cracking boxes like that and either like drafting or, you know, again, being creative with the cards that you get to play against each other is a lot more fun than looking up and
like having a friend that is into it like as much as you like really helps.
Yeah, that's the biggest thing, because once one person phases out, then everyone starts to quickly move along.
And you're just buying packs and opening up yourself, and it's like,
what am I doing?
Get a hobby, get a real hobby, get a light. Stop opening up Pokemon cards as an adult.
Yeah, exactly. So, since you were kind of going on and off a little bit there, at what point did you find Pokemon to become a serious kind of? I mean, the type of collector you are, you seem to be a true collector, not really. I mean, yeah, you're doing investing and
true TM collector.
And, you know, it's hard to ignore the money aspect at this point. So at what point did you seriously start to take Pokemon as a collecting hobby or as an investment? When did you discover graded cards?
Right. That's a good segue. So it was 2013.
Okay.
My younger cousin comes back from like, I don't know if it was like a comic book convention, anime convention or something like that. And he was telling me how he saw like a first edition Charizard for sale there. Mm-hmm. And he told me it was $500, 2013.
Okay.
And I'm like, and it was a card that like I always wanted.
Right.
I mean, Charizard, I don't even have to explain that. It was a card I always wanted. And like at that point, like my heart kind of sunk. I'm like, $500? This is 2013. So I don't.
Still.
I think that was just after high school or something like that. Mm-hmm. So that was like a lot of money for like one card.
Right.
So then I'm like, if I want it, like it's only going to go up in value. I have to buy it like sooner rather than later.
Oh,
and so like I wanted to verify the price too, the $500.
How'd you do that? eBay?
eBay. I jumped on eBay, and at the time, like it's basically eBirdman and Gary are the only people selling things on eBay that's graded. A lot smaller back then.
Okay.
And then I'm looking through, and then I think that the price of a PSA 9 Charizard at that time was around like $600.
Yeah.
And then I'm just like looking through, I'm like, I'm looking at the prices of these things, and I'm seeing like PSA 8 first edition base set cards, Gary's listing them for like $60 each. And I'm like, you know what? Like, I want them. I want them. So I messaged Gary on eBay, and then I picked up like five or six PSA 8 first edition holos for like $60 a piece.
Oh, wow.
It's not those ones. Those are nines.
Yeah.
But I started with eights. Just because like nines were like an extra $20 at the time. It was, I don't know, Maybe I should have gone with the nines, but
You started as an eight collector and moved your way up.
yeah.
One day it'll be
And I actually
tens.
picked up a few 8.5s just because they were, I mean, if given the option between 8 and 8.5, like, why not?
Right. That's
So I
it.
think that YouTube actually right there is, if you scroll down, sorry, there's actually a delay.
The zoomed in one.
Yeah, I think that was the first 8.5 Mewtwo ever graded, and that was the one from Gary.
Oh, wow.
Fun
I mean that's cool that you thought you had that thought right away of either just going to keep going up in price. Because I remember when I first got back into it, I was, you as everyone does, you see these prices and it's crazy how much they are.
Yeah.
When, at any point in time when you got back into the hobby, the prices were crazy and they always will be.
Yeah.
And I did not have that first thought of I have to get this; it's going to keep going up in value. It was I have to get this and sell it right away because
Yeah.
I don't know what it's going to be worth later on. But until you start to educate yourself more and understand that there's this huge community of collectors and really nitpicking each little card on and discovering graded, the PSA stuff and all that, you realize that it's a fun little thing to start investing in. So what did you start off with then? You started off with the first edition base set. Did you
Yeah.
just kind of go set by set to collect, a binder of each? Did you go for PSA 8s of everything, PSA 9s of everything? What did you do when you were, what
Yeah.
was your first goal?
My first goal is just to have a first edition holo set. The grade didn't really matter at the time. I just kind of picked the grade that I was comfortable paying with, which was 8 for a lot of them. Some of them, like, I think I got the Poliwrath at 9 just because it was cheaper. And I first bought like a slew of them because it combined the shipping, and shipping to Canada is a pain.
Oh, right.
That was from Gary, right? And I think I paid the equivalent of one first edition Charizard or something. So I should have just started off with the Charizard. That was the first mistake. But yeah, so my goal was just like a PSA graded first edition holo set. And then I started picking up more and more nines of those, like a couple more. This is still like 2013.
Okay, so you're just getting doubles of each card, though, but.
Yeah, so upgrading. Yeah, like I upgraded like the Gyarados. I think I bought my nine at like $90 or something like back then.
And then would you sell the eight to kind of recoup some of the cost?
No, I didn't. I think I still have a lot of the eights. I
Oh,
sold
wow.
a couple. I had a Venusaur that I paid $60 for an eight, and then I just recently traded it for like $400 worth of value, something
Wow.
like that.
Do you even have an eBay account where you sell?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, because.
I don't like to associate my account with my online persona, just because I don't want like people trolling my account or anything.
Right. Yeah, that's what I've done for a while, but then I realized, what the hell, I'll try to.
Yeah.
I think I've got some faithful people following me, so I might increase sales, but.
Yeah. Well, once you have a persona going, it makes sense too, because then people will buy from you and they know who you are.
Yeah.
Whereas I don't sell that much, so it doesn't really matter.
Yeah. Okay. So you've just been stocking up on PSA 9s forever, which is a very interesting thing, especially in today's market, because I mean you get memed on and about these nines nonstop
Yeah,
and have been
people are
for
brutal.
forever. And the new meme is the LCC community, which is also taken kind of seriously, I think. The was it low capital or low cost?
It's either one.
Either.
Yeah, I can give a little background.
Yeah, please do. Once the
Okay.
fire alarm goes off.
Yeah, so our Lord and Savior, SM Pratt, in one of his videos, I don't even remember what the video was about, but it was kind of a tangent, and he's talking about like the type of collector that he likes are people like quote unquote like PFM and Zini, who that's me and someone else from the Discord, who are these like low cost or low capital collectors that spend like $100 a month and just like love the hobby, right? And I'm like, wow, that's flattering, but no. But it kind of started a meme, where like it kind of distinguishes the people that buy for themselves versus buying for the sake of reselling. And like I spend more than $100 a month, if I'm gonna be honest, on cards. So I don't know if I would even count like the low capital, but I think the idea is that like what I'm buying is basically sunk money, right? I buy and I keep it. So like my money only flows one way for the most part.
Gotcha.
So like I can't make these like impulsive large purchases all the time. because like I'm not making any money from back from it most of the time.
Right, because you're just hoarding everything.
Right. So I have to be like a little bit more conscious about what I'm buying. Right. So I can't just go out and splurge on tens. Like I'd rather, like my goal right now is to have every like set WotC holo first edition mm-hmm. in PSA 9.
Okay.
Right. And cool. If I were to do that for PSA 10s, that would just be like unrealistic for me.
Yeah. Yeah, I got.
So it was like, and I had this dilemma at one point where when I was buying Fossil in Jungle right after base, and I was like, do I want to buy 10s or do I want to buy 9s? And like I'm just looking, and it's like the amount I could buy if I bought 9s is like so much more vast than the amount if I stuck with 10s.
Okay.
Right. And, like I could buy like basically every WotC holo for the PSA 9 for the price of like one Neo Genesis first edition set.
Yeah, that's right. That's true. Yeah, and it's probably been that way for a while now. I mean,
yeah.
I mean, that Pratt was preaching for a while how PSA 9s were so undervalued. And just recently with how the grading standards have changed, not on paper, but just how they've been with PSA and Beckett, getting 10s is impossible, and 9s are just creeping up really fast. So the sticking true to your budget, your goals, and getting what you want has really benefited you, because looking at a percentage return rate, I'm sure PSA 9s have done very well in comparison to a lot of the 10s out there. I mean, take out the Charizard and the, you know, the biggest names, but I mean, you're collecting a little bit of everything, so there's been a great return on your stuff. And I know you post a lot in the Discord, because you log everything into your PSA account on your phone, on the app.
Yeah, I use the set registry to like record prices and when I buy things and who I buy them from, whatever.
Yeah, which is really useful. You're able to log in how much you paid for it, and then does it? It just updates based on PSA's estimated value, right? Not what you put it in as.
No, that's what they're like. You can change that current value. Field, but I don't even look at that because that's like just the SMR estimate, and it's usually like way off.
Yeah, they're super low, always looking at the magazines.
I care about the price I paid it and like when I bought it. So like right now I'm looking on the app and I see I bought like a first edition Mr. Mime from Jungle PSA 9 for $19 in 2017.
Wow.
Right.
And back then it would cost maybe $5 to grade a card, and now today it costs $15 to grade the card.
And that's with shipping too, right? So like shipping, eBay fees, it's like at one point in time it was just stupid. You can buy PSA 9s for like $20-$25 on auction. People were just dumping them because they were opening boxes, mm-hmm. grading the card, keeping the 10s, and just recuperating whatever they could on 9s. So they're just dumping their 9s, especially Jungle, Fossil, Rocket, because they all at once that was kind of happening.
Yeah, you always see little themes of each set kind of going crazy and then something else coming up. But yeah, that's cool. I mean, I always get really jealous when I see you post things in the Discord of the 9s you get for like $25, $20 still today. like I saw you got a legendary collection, I think Alakazam, for like $25, and I was like, dang it!
I could double check that, like $25, like PSA 9. I don't know what the 10 goes for. I don't even really care. Like,
yeah, I mean, they're so similar in the way they look too, especially if you just get like a well centered one. There's rarely any distinction between those grades.
Yeah. Usually it's on the back end. It's like a little chip or whatever. And if you're not looking on the back end, does it even matter? Right. So yeah, I paid $26.56, and I think I used my eBay bucks, so it was free.
That's amazing. Yeah, then as soon as I see something like that, I always hop on eBay and try to find something similar to it. And I end up paying like $30 instead of your $25 or something. But... realize that
I picked out the cheapest option, I guess.
But like even at $30 for a 9.2 is great. No joke. It's phenomenal.
It's like I know Colgate's Beedrill, like people were talking about that car a couple months ago, mm-hmm. Because like the 10 sold for like $600 or something. Mm-hmm. And I'm sitting here like I paid $25 for my 9 copy. Like, and what is the difference? A lot of the times, like the difference between 9 and 10 is like either it's sometimes not even existent. Like I have 9s that are so clean. Yeah. I could easily get a 10 if I regrade it.
Yeah.
And I have 10s with scratches, and it's like, what am I paying for at this point?
Right. So, I mean, all the people listening out there, they got to understand that, you know, if they're really in it for themselves or for the money or whatever they're doing, PSA 9s are a great option both ways because you can get the same beautiful cards for the same or for such a lower cost. And I mean, I don't know if it's at the point where we've, you know, missed out on a nice little bump on these things, but I still see so much room for growth with these nines because of, especially with sealed product being as scarce as it is, and mint loose cards being as scarce as they are. It's there's so many tens out there that are just not for sale anymore. You don't see PSA 10 like Shadowless Blastoise. You don't see these things at auction ever because they're just, no one wants to sell them. Everyone's holding on to stuff. It's getting a little wild.
Yeah. Lately, it's been hard, like, trying to find good deals on nines just because there's, like, nothing out there anymore.
Yeah, it's weird.
Like you're saying, with people opening up boxes and, like, there's no more boxes to open. There's nothing left to grade. No one wants to sell what they have, so.
Mm-hmm. So how far are you into this Hollow Nine sets? Are you getting close? Is it just WotC, or are you doing all of your EX series as well? Or
I got it. If you look through my Instagram, you'll see like I have a lot of EXs and nines, but mostly WotC right now. And I have like Base done. I have Fossil, Jungle, Rocket done. I have one of the easier gym set. What is it? Gym Heroes done.
Yep.
I'm almost on Gym Challenge.
I just got a lot of nines in.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, we'll have to talk after this. I'll show you what I got. I got too many nines. I sent in like I think almost the full Gym Challenge set. I found a guy with just tons of mint cards, and I tried to buy him out. He wouldn't sell them all to me, unfortunately. But I did pretty well with them. Got like four or five tens, and then about nine nines. And
did you say it was from, was it from a pack or you bought the
no cards? I bought they're loose raw cards. Some dude, okay,
that's
pretty good. My local store that I buy from in Michigan, some guy came in who used to be a sports dealer, had like those 5,000 cardboard boxes, and just had every set from Base Unlimited to Gym Challenge first edition and unlimited stuff, not base but everything else, and just full like four or five sets of each. It was insane how much this
clearly mint too. If you're getting tens on them,
yeah,
still.
Yeah, they were great. So, yeah. Unfortunately, I couldn't get them all, but I picked out the best ones that I could, that I had time to look at. So, let's see what else have you done in the community? I know you've been. I met you at Worlds for the first time this year, or last year, I guess 2019 in
Washington.
Washington, D.C. I got to spend a few days together and went exploring a little bit. We went sightseeing and see the White House and hanging out in Jem Mint's room, just having a good time.
I should say to anyone listening, if like you want to come to Worlds, like book your ticket and come to Worlds because it's a great time.
Yeah. Yeah. It's phenomenal. And
are you coming to London this year?
I am.
I
booked the hotel for the event. Still waiting to do the plane ticket because I don't know where I'm going to be leaving from yet. I know I still have time. I think it's still fairly cheap because right now I'm in California. It's like $500-$600 to fly out of here, but I'm moving back to Michigan. So,
yeah,
but it's like $1,000 out of there. I don't know if what you paid for your ticket, but or if you've even
I haven't booked the ticket. I just booked the hotel so far.
Okay. Yeah. Because I think I'm going to go with Swolepoke. And we're going to go explore maybe like Paris and some other places. We just have to figure out all the logistics of it. But during the event, you know, it's 3 days, 4 days of just hanging out with, you know, especially just kind of focused on the E4 group, really, because we're close enough to, you know, we talk to each other quite frequently. So it's a lot of fun. It was 2019 your first Worlds?
No, I went to Nashville as well.
Okay.
So that's 2019 Worlds on my Instagram.
Yep. Well, that's
keep going down. You'll see like the Nashville, like the Pikachu with the banjo.
There he is.
Yeah. 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 It's fun to pick up those staff cards in person too, you know?
Like, yeah. Yeah. I unfortunately flipped mine. I bought two or three of them.
Only, man. Yeah. Next year you got to do better than that. You got to get like at least 10.
Yeah. I'm going to be prowling around trying to get as much as I can to help pay for the trip.
Yeah.
But that's going to be interesting because I feel like a lot more people are picking up on this stuff and will be more conscious of trying to get it. So it's gonna, I think prices are gonna be a little bit more challenging in London.
I don't know. It's hard to say because like there's a bigger market than who's at Worlds, you know. So when you go from Worlds to the bigger market, people are just gonna pay more. That's it.
And I don't know how many people are going to be able to make it out there because it's such a far trip and people think it. I mean, it's really not going to be that expensive in comparison to some of these other ones
Yeah,
in the States. So
that is true.
I
It's just
wonder.
Americans like to complain about anything outside the
We gotta have our way.
country.
It's gotta be across the street from our apartments so we can
Yeah.
walk
Well,
there.
there'll be a lot of people there. There'll be a lot of Europeans. But the difference is now, the Europeans don't like those on eBay, the European market and the US market is typically like isolated from each other.
And they haven't
You know?
experienced this before, so that maybe they won't really know what they're doing, and we can
Right.
we can scoop up all the good stuff.
But think about it, like if you go there and you pick up a bunch of cards, and when people go on eBay, they'll see like, oh, I can get it from like, oh, some guy from Sweden or some guy from Germany. But it's gonna cost like $20 shipping.
And
Or I
take a
can get it
week.
from this Pokemon Radar guy,
That's me.
$3 shipping.
No, everything's free shipping. Look at
That's
my.
well, there you go. That's money in your pocket.
That's
It's
right.
nothing's free, but yeah.
It'll be interesting. It'll be a lot of fun. I'm curious to see how it goes, and looking forward to seeing you again. So
Yeah, it'll be fun.
we'll have a good time while we're out there. So what's kind of your what's on your radar? What's on your Pokemon radar now? What are you looking for, collecting wise? I mean, outside of the rest of your holo set, do you have your eyes set on anything else?
Right. So one of the things, I don't know how big the delay is between us right now on the screen, but I think you just scroll past it. But a PSA 10. PSA 10, yeah, be careful. Don't panic. The P promo Japanese set is something I've been trying to collect over a long period of time right now, like a couple years.
Where is that?
It's on the left column. There's like a bunch of PSA slabs on top of each other. Japanese, yeah, that one.
What is this?
So that's the P promo set. It's like the first. Okay, so
2002.
Japanese have like old back and new back, right? Right, so this is like right when they switched to the new back, they started numbering their promos. So this is technically like the first set of numbered promos. It's around like 2001, I think, for them.
Oh, so it's like the Black Star promos of Japan. I get,
Ah,
or
yeah, more.
that.
I mean, like they had promos before this, they were just always on. They were like in the Illustrator would be like one of them, and all the Korokoros and whatever. But this is the first set where they actually started numbering them.
And you're doing tens. Wow.
Yeah.
Little out of your
Yeah, it's
comfort,
pretty cool.
your
Like, no, it's not true because with tens in Japanese, they're just so much easier to achieve. So they typically go for around the same as nines.
Oh, really? Yeah, I haven't looked at too, I've never done too much grading in my past time. I've been doing it more lately, but so how big is this set?
I just want to double check before I put a number on it. 47 cards,
Is
and
it
I've gotten 39. I'm just, and some of them I
still
have raw
ongoing?
integrate. Yeah.
Okay.
And there's one card in this set. It's the P008. You may have heard of it. It's like the Tropical Wind card. That one that like Scott has on his eBay that's like there's only two of them in the world or four of them or whatever.
The one he has up for
So
$500,000.
yeah, that one. So that one's actually a numbered promo and part of that set, number eight. And I don't think I'll ever get it unless some miracle happens.
Wait,
So
there's only four of them?
there's
Known?
not made for, not for made, but like only like I know Scott has one. I know there's another person on Instagram that has one. And I think there's two listed on Yahoo Japan now or something for like obscene amounts. So there's like four that have surfaced since
Interesting.
2001.
Wow. Never heard of that. I just bought my first 99 Tropical Wind not too long ago, and
I saw.
I've got the medal. I've been wearing it the past few podcasts.
That's what you're wearing there.
Makes me feel like a winner. I also just pulled up the base set box here. Why don't you tell us a little bit about this? This is an interesting story. If this is the right base set box that I'm thinking of.
That Pokemon Steve 13 that you deserve at PFF. Thank you. Thank you. My Australian buddy there. Okay. Yeah, I was just like on eBay and I saw it and it was like a good price. And I'm like, I kind of want a box. And like, this is something I would consider like more of an investment rather than like a, it's just something I want that like I can, it'll always go up in value in my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
So I just figured why not? It was like a decent price. I don't remember exactly what I paid. 3,000, 4,000, something there.
Okay. And then what happened?
Just like YOLO bought it.
And then what happened when it arrived? Is this the
oh,
right?
Oh, yeah. You want, so I shipped it to my middleman who also came to Worlds in Washington. And he gave it to me and he was like, oh, you know, it smells a little bit like smoke. So it's like my little cigarette smoke box. I shouldn't be saying this now. I just immediately decreased the value like that, like $500. What are you doing to me here? Terrible investment.
It's aired out by now.
No, honestly, I think it's mostly clean.
But yeah.
It definitely had an odor of cigarette.
That's so unfortunate. We were joking around that it was the smoke from Ken Sugimori's smoke room, personal
yeah,
smoke Ken's, room.
Yeah. Arita and Sugimori, when they get together in their downtime, they the smoke room.
it's just thrones of Bayset boxes, and they
yeah
sit down
for
on
some
them.
Reason. They're English, but whatever.
So is that kind of like, I, you know, you don't have to let me know your positions on things, but do you have a lot of sealed boxes? Is it something that you like you said, it's more of an investment for you? But
yeah, that's just the one. I don't have any. Okay. I have a few like ultra shiny GXs or some Japanese, whatever, but that's like the only WotC English thing.
Okay. Do you buy a lot of the new sets at all just to collect a binder set of things?
No,
or?
It's too hard and too much. Honestly, it's too much money.
Yeah.
Like each card on its own is very, like it's a trivial amount of money, but like it adds up really quickly.
Mm-hmm.
And like in Canada too, like the shipping burden, if I buy them all separately or singles or whatever.
That really adds up then, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Are there not, is there not a lot of heavy distribution of sealed boxes up there for you to get decent prices on things? Like, I mean, I kind of do that if I make an impulse purchase, but it's usually based on what set looks nice, like Hidden Fates or Shining Legends or Evolutions. Okay. You know, I'd buy some product just to enjoy opening it and try to put together a set. And, you know, we find pretty good prices on eBay here, at least, because you got these distributors who are dumping product for $85 a box. But there's nothing like, yeah. I mean, that's not something you've ever.
Here, we have to pay for shipping and we have to pay, like, custom. So it's okay. Kind of built into the price of every box.
Okay.
And the exchange rate. And, you know, like, the exchange rate's not just a straight exchange rate. They'll like PayPal always takes like 2% or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
It's like those numbers like start adding up, and like I'm just looking at the price and it's just not worth it. I like the if I have money, the amount of stuff I can buy modern versus vintage is like no contest,
right?
Like I might as well just go with the vintage stuff.
Yeah, and you're just buying what you like. I mean, that's one of the big things. Like I know people always hit you up about, hey, I got PSA 9s, you want to buy them? It's it's more you're just buying the artworks that you like or what you need in your collection.
Yeah, if I see something I want, I just buy it. That's just like pretty straightforward. That's just like collecting. That's
yeah, yeah, yeah. You're a true collector. What's your favorite card in your collection or your favorite set in your collection?
Don't do this to me. Hold on. If you scroll down a little, like one Instagram row, there's that picture. With the Lopunny and the five cards. Yeah, that one.
What?
So I think that was supposed to be like, there was like some Instagram trend or whatever. Everyone was like, do your top five.
Oh, yeah.
And at the time, that's what I picked. So
hashtag top five. We've got a 9 miscut Sylveon from Furious Fist.
That was a free card from Mason. I memed it up on the Discord for a while there.
All right. We've got the... Your Rayquaza that you pulled yourself at a
yeah,
4.
That's the one.
You've got.
Which is now signed by Fukuda, by the way.
Did you break it out?
No, I got him to sign the case. Just because I like the story of having the 4 on it, and I didn't want to lose the story.
Okay.
I want to add to the story.
Is it an actual 4 or is it a little bit better?
It's a, well, it's a 4.
It's a 4.
I think a 4 is a fair grade.
Okay, understood. You got the Pokemon Festa 2002 there. What's the story behind that one?
That was a PWCC purchase.
Oh.
I don't know, maybe a couple years ago now, but it was like the first kind of Japanese promo card that like I decided to buy.
Okay.
Because I saw it was Pikachu. It looked like a unique artwork. If you read the Wikipedia page, it's actually, there's a Smash Bros. Reference in the card.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I don't remember exactly what it is. I think the attack's called Smash Link or something, and it has Pikachu and Mewtwo,
I need to
and that
buy
was
that
right when
card.
Melee was out.
Oh, Melee, dude.
Right. Yeah. And I think I bought it for like $40, which is a really good deal,
Wow.
on auction. And it just kind of got me started into collecting that, and that's the P promo set. So that one led me to there's that card's part of a bigger collection of cards, like the artwork, the JR Rally,
Okay.
where it's like every card is like a part of a bigger picture.
Oh.
So I collected that set, and then all those are part of the P promos too. So I'm like, I might as well just collect all the P promos.
I wonder, is there artwork of this picture where you can like see the full
Yes. Can
Mewtwo?
I let me see if I can find it.
Yeah, you can throw it in Discord or something. That's really cool. I mean, I kind of want to do a podcast about Super Smash Melee now. That's a cool card. I've never seen that before. It's kind of funky with just the bottom half of Mewtwo
Yes.
there. And then this Voltorb,
Right.
Shadowless.
So
What is this?
that one has a little bit of a story to it. That one's supposed to be signed by the artist, which
Who
is
who's the artist?
Keiji Kanabuchi.
Okay.
He's like the guy that did all the original CGI, like the Diglett for base set and the Voltorb and the Magneton.
Okay.
Like, are that kind of cringy CGI.
The boring stuff, yeah.
And supposedly he died in like 2003.
Really?
If you like really scour Google, you can find like there's some weird Japanese blog post about some guy who used to claim to be his friend or something, and he's talking about like how it's very sad that he died in 2003. And
Really?
it kind of makes sense because that also corresponds to like the last card he made, which is
Okay.
it was corresponds to Aquapolis. And if you know like the Aquapolis, the Grimer, the one with its mouth open in the sewer,
Yeah.
like that's probably one of the last cards. If he did die,
Is that the
and
one that
that's
looks like a
probably one of the
muck?
last cards he did.
Oh, wow.
And that
So
one is
it's.
allegedly signed by him, but I have no way of actually verifying because I've never seen another signed example.
Where'd you get it?
This one came from, I don't remember the guy's eBay name, but I know he lives in Washington, and I know that he has stuff coming to him that clearly comes from a WotC employee. So I know that he has a connection to a WotC employee. And when I
Okay.
asked him where it came from, he said it came from a WotC employee. So
Wow.
that's the story I have.
Wow. That's pretty cool.
Yeah. So I don't know if it's real or not, but
Hey, I'll take
it's
it.
cool.
Yeah,
If
that's really cool.
it's real, it's cool.
Yeah, that's a nice card then. A real nice card. And then, of course, right next to it, you've got the big dog here. Or no, the Master Key's the big dog. You've got
It's
the
the
Master
smaller
Scroll,
dog.
the Master Scroll, the Gem 10 there. What do those go for now? They're a few thousand, right? Three,
I'll tell
four.
you in a couple of days because there's one right now in auction, PSA
Oh,
10.
interesting. Did you grade this one yourself?
I did.
So you bought it in the original paperwork and all that.
It didn't come with the paperwork. It was already open, but I bought it from, okay, so just a random day on the Discord, just chilling. Someone comes in, SSJC, thanks, SSJC, Collins. He comes in, he drops a Yahoo Japan link, says like, wow, this is a good deal. And I don't remember the exact price, but I want to say it was like 500 US, let's put it there at the time. And it was just a picture of only the front. So there was no picture of the back. $500 at the time was a good price, but like it was kind of like a risk because if it was a dent, if it had a dent, then it would get like a six or something.
Right.
And it probably wouldn't have been worth it.
Are they notorious for dents or anything? Do they have any
No.
the way they were put in the.
They're not easy grades. Usually Japanese newbacks are very easy, but that one there's a bit of a difficulty to it, but you know, most of them are nines and tens.
Okay.
So I just kind of YOLO bought it, just like the box. I'm like, why not? It looks cool. $500 isn't that much too. And like it's a
No.
card, it's rare, and it has gone up since then.
Oh yeah, quite a
When it
bit.
came in, it was very clean and I graded it and got a 10, so
Nice. Yeah,
yeah.
it's tough to tell the front of that thing if there's anything going on with it, any damage because of how sparkly and bright that thing is.
Yeah.
So how do you store all your cards? You got quite a bit of PSA cards. I'm still not sold on collecting PSA cards myself, simply for the fact of space and having
Yeah.
to put them anywhere. What do you do with all your slabs?
Yeah, they're thick. That's one benefit to PSA over BGS, another benefit
Oh
in
yeah.
addition to many other things. The BGS ones are actually even thicker.
Yeah.
But I don't know how much detail I should give, but like I have a gun safe somewhere.
Okay.
And in Canada, we don't put guns in gun safes because we don't have guns to put in gun safes. So my gun safe is just like cards.
Okay. That's cool.
Nice. That's where most of them are. And I have some, I have them in like two different locations. Mostly just shoved in like the PSA submission boxes because they're like, they're literally designed to hold PSA cards.
Yeah.
Free.
Yeah, good point. I usually get rid of those. Well, yeah, no, don't. I got a couple of them. I got one right here,
they're,
actually.
It's good to have some just handy because, like I said, they're literally designed to hold the cards.
Yeah. Yeah, perfect fits.
Yeah.
All right. Did you send in that... that pre-release Raichu yourself?
I did.
When was that?
And don't tell anyone this, but I actually wrote the pre-release on it too myself.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I couldn't even tell. Really.
Don't tell anyone. Anyone who hasn't read the comments on this thing, they are hilarious. Like, people like are treating it like it's serious, and I just.
That's risky, man. I mean, I feel like they'd flag you at PSA or something.
Actually, you know what? I think I put that one right next. You can check the serial numbers because it'll correspond. But I think that was right next to the master scroll.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Jeez. I got message about a pre-release Raichu all in Dallas from, I think, someone selling one in Australia.
Oh yeah, I'm sure it's real. It's real as this one.
I think they were using Pratt's picture or something. I don't know.
But yeah,
it's unbelievable. It's so funny. It's still. I think it's got this cool story tie behind it, and it's got this cool aura. But I still would never touch it.
I mean, there's one version of the card that you can trace all the way back to, like, the original WotC employee.
Right.
And like I would pay money for that card, but I would not pay for any other one.
Oh, that's interesting. I just feel like it's such a hard sell after that. I mean, the person that has it won't sell, I don't think.
I don't think so either.
So,
and even if they did, I don't know if I'd be able to dish out like I think they paid like 10 grand. I don't think I'd be able to top that.
Yeah, I don't think it.
I could, but I don't think I'd want to.
Right, right. That's a lot to be.
Like LCC.
That's a lot of nines. That's a lot of nines.
Yeah. And how, like, what would I do? Like, oh yeah, look, I, you know, trust me, it's the real one. Trust me, like.
Right, and you have to like get in touch with all the people that had it beforehand, so you could get the reference and.
Like deep down, I would know, but.
Right.
You know, it's a job to convince other people.
Yeah. Yeah. Gosh. That's such a cool story. Not that I'm trying to bump up the price of that thing, but it's pretty cool. All right. Well, nice. I'm trying to think of some other things to come up with. You've got quite the... Oh, yeah.
No. Don't do this to me.
All right. I won't. But I'm going to... I'll do a cool... So I saw... You're a fan of bunnies.
Why do you phrase it like that?
I don't know.
Like, if you like dogs, are you a fan of dogs?
Yes, I do. I do say that.
You see why that could be a little a bit of an issue.
I got to see the commission that you had done. I don't know if you've shared this with people yet.
I can send it on the Discord if you want.
Yeah, that'd be cool because it turned out really nice. I believe Vehicular Menace did that for you or picked it up for you.
Yes, she picked it up for me, and I thank her very much for that.
Yeah, Fukuda was doing 4 commissions per panel, so 8 total. Luckily, Swolpoke and I were able to get one for ourselves that he brought as examples, but the one that you had done was really cool.
Thank you. I linked it on the Discord if you want to take a little sneak peek.
Is it in where on the Discord? In the there it is. Got it.
One, yeah. Let's and pull that's this the only up. Image I have, so that's the best you get.
Yep. There it is. We got
there it is.
The holy
I
angel bunny.
Specifically for a rabbit with wings, and I wanted it to be and a sword, and I wanted to be in a square and popping out like the gold stars. That's basically what I asked in.
Okay.
That's what he delivered.
Looks like the Soul Calibur sword. Very nice.
Yeah, I love the detail he put into it, though. It's crazy.
Oh, it's great. And, you got the 2020 signature. Ours had the 2019 on them, but That it's so cool. I think that this type of thing is, like I've mentioned before, is something I'm looking for from Pokemon artists. I mean, unfortunately, we'll never see, or maybe we will, hand-drawn artwork of, pre-approval Pokemon stuff. But, this is the closest we're gonna get so far. I mean, this could very easily be a Pokemon that he submitted at some point and they said no to. I mean, obviously you gave him the idea, but you can
No,
make that up.
if it ever becomes a Pokemon,
Yeah, that's right. This could
I claim the royalties.
Gen 11 right there. And here's a couple of
Then
the
I
other.
linked my the two cards I sent in for. I don't have them back yet either, but
Okay.
for
Well,
whatever reason, like he signed mine at like the last hour that he was there or something in the staff signing, and for whatever reason, he signed them both in English.
yeah, that's odd because he didn't want to do that.
No, yeah,
That's kind of
because like
cool.
I.
That's unique.
It's unique. I honestly, I would have preferred the Japanese, but like
Yeah.
again, like I wasn't there to put a gun to his head or anything.
Right. That's the
But I
tough
think
thing.
it's kind of neat because it is unique. But either
Yeah.
way, it's signed by him, so
Yeah,
I'm
it's
not
really cool.
complaining.
Yeah, I saw Charlie did his live Instagram of all the cards he got signed, and he got I don't want to I don't he got stuck with the same signature on every single card. He didn't get the official one, at least from what I saw, which I think this one is way better.
Yeah, that one
Just
looks like his signature.
yeah,
The ones I have, it looks like I could have just done it. That's the thing that kind of.
right. And I think he did say this was his official signature, and the other one was just his name written in Japanese. So, but yeah, you got that on your artwork there. So that was really cool. What about this one here, actually? Who is this?
That's
Toshinao?
Leanheart. Go to the
That's
right.
Leanheart's?
Yeah. Oh yeah.
That's
Just
awesome.
asked to give me like a thumbnail surprised face right there, and he
It's
delivered.
perfect. You got the little smiley face on there.
Yeah, that's
Yeah,
actually a nice signature. Yeah.
beautiful. What other signatures you got? Are you trying to get as many as you can now? I mean, signatures is a big thing, a very popular
Yeah, I've been
sub.
picking them up before they were popular, but some after. Like this one is Harada. Who I don't. There's like a story behind that. Let's not go into that. But
When
like those two cards I picked up from some guy that was at like the 2004, I think it says on it, Worlds, and he's actually on the Wikipedia page as a player, which is cool because I can like prove that he was there.
Oh, that's cool.
I think she was signing at that one. So,
Yeah. Is she
and then
doing
the
one
Lugia is a
soon?
print. Sorry.
Is she doing a signing soon, or did she do one recently?
She did one recently, but I don't think it went very well.
Okay.
So I don't know. I don't know what the. There's a story there, but
Oh,
I don't know
we don't have
enough
to get
details
into
to
it.
like give it accurately.
Okay, what's the Lugia one? This is really cool.
That was at wherever she signed last in Europe. Somebody got it signed there, and I picked it up from some guy on Instagram
That's a really cool
before my
print.
trip.
I like that Entei up there. That's nice.
What's his name? He's from Sweden. It's okay. Sorry.
Oh, sorry, no shout out for you.
Martin collects. There he is. He's right there on the
Mark,
right.
all
That's
right.
where I got it from.
Okay. Yeah, I mean something like this, like an original artwork like that, where is it?
Yeah.
You know,
It's copyright infringement.
it's unbelievable. That's so cool. I mean, I'm sure it's somewhere in a file. Knowing I work for a Japanese company, so knowing the Japanese, it's just inside a cabinet
Yeah.
somewhere.
You know what's interesting? The one woman who does the clay artwork. I mean, she must have those clay figures somewhere, like in her house or something.
Oh, that's it. I've never thought of that. That's
If someone
interesting.
wants to hit up, like, what's her name? Like Yukimori or something? Hit her up and ask her for some like clay original artwork.
That's funny. I wonder, do you think that's how she actually does it?
Yeah, she does. Like, I follow her on Instagram if you.
Oh, really? Does she show her process?
It's mostly just unrelated to Pokemon stuff, but she'll occasionally show like the cards that she's made.
Okay. That's cool. Oh, and then here's the card I got to sign actually too at
Yeah, you
Worlds.
should be on there. That was a lot of people signing that one.
Yeah, this is a good looking card. We got some big names on here. Gary from Pawn Stars. You
Yeah.
got the classic Cool Trainer Ryan. Leonhard again. You got Pokemon Radar.
Yeah.
DJ Gigabyte. He was on the
I
podcast.
got like every podcast member on here at some
Swolpoke.
point.
Oh, Pokemon Revolution. Yeah, I got to use this for my next people to hit up. Very
Could you
cool.
imagine that slab with a PSA label that goes like a mile long with all the names on
That's awesome. I wonder if anyone sent in a Gary from Pawn Stars sign to get authenticated or
I
slabbed.
guarantee you at some point they would maybe not the first submission, maybe not the second submission, but maybe by the third submission they would actually start.
Yeah.
I feel like they slab a lot of weird names.
That's funny. And of course, Quackalackin.
Quackalackin.
Well, cool. Well, you know, we're coming up in an hour here. You know, that's typically where I like to end things. And I think we had a pretty nice conversation. I always enjoy talking with you, hanging out with you in Discord.
Yeah. Episode 10.
Episode 10, we did
It's a
it.
wrap.
Guys, we made it. We made it. But yeah, if you're not doing it yet, you might want to, you know, start following a little bit of PFM's. Just follow his strategy, follow his path. I think it's a smart way to go, especially if you're starting to get back into Pokemon at first, or if you are a LCC member and don't even know it yet. That it's the way to go. I mean, you still get beautiful cards in beautiful condition at a great price, and yeah, just keep an eye out for those steals and have it up on eBay ready to go, win those auctions, and maybe help PFM's collection start to go up a little bit more in value.
Let me finish it before you start collecting.
Yeah, exactly. Don't buy out all the
Don't
gym
start
challenge
buying knives
nines.
just yet. You can start buying your jungle and fossil knives. There you go.
Right, start with that. Listen to PFM, he knows what he's talking about. All right, well, thanks a lot, man. I appreciate your time coming on the show, coming on the podcast.
Thanks for the invite.
Yeah, I will definitely hit you up after this about the gym challenge cards you need in case I have any.
Will do.
And we'll talk that out. So, thanks again. Make sure you guys check him out on Instagram. I don't know the story behind the Murkrow, but hey, maybe he just likes them.
I love Murkrow.
Yeah.
That's so.
Well, I think that was the first darkness type card ever.
Yeah, I think you're right.
Yeah, back in one of the Neo sets. So, there he is, man. PFM, I just collect cards. That's his motto.
That's it. I just collect cards.
Does nothing else. But all right, thanks again, and thank you all, everyone that tuned in to watch. Next week,